taking berberine is looking like it's going to be a valuable strategy, not only to curb insulin spikes, but in the fight against longevity. Problem is, it's just not that bioavailable. Well, problem solved. Today, we'll be talking about a version of berberine that's much more bioavailable, dihydroberberine. Hey guys, Lance here. And I just want to let you guys know that I've recently published an online program called The Longevity Guide, Biohacking Your Longevity. Check it out up here, or I'll tell you more about it at the end of the video. Okay, so in today's video, I'm going to be talking with Lucas Aoun, a YouTuber from Australia. Lucas has a channel called Boost Your Biology, and he's talking about men's health and performance. He talks a lot about nutrition and supplementation on his channel, and today he's going to be talking with us about berberine and the more bioavailable version, dihydroberberine. Hey, welcome back, Lucas. It's great to have you back on the channel again. Now, the first time you were on, you gave a lot of great advice, so I'm hoping to get more of the same. And this time, I'd like to talk about berberine and dihydroberberine.
Sure. So berberine is definitely a versatile supplement in the health and longevity space. And you know, most of the research conducted on berberine itself has been to optimize insulin sensitivity and lower blood glucose levels. But I've always been fascinated with different metabolites and different compounds that are similar to the lead compound. And in this case, we're looking at a metabolite of berberine known as dihydroberberine. And so I'm really excited to share some of the novel benefits associated with this particular metabolite.
Right. So I've done several videos both on metformin and on berberine. And I always get a lot of questions, especially the last one that I did about, you know, what about dihydroberberine? Can I use that instead? And I tell people, yeah, absolutely. It's more bioavailable. So before we jump into dihydroberberine, I know that metformin is kind of controversial. There's been a lot of talk over the last few years about the benefits of metformin for longevity. I know that Dr. Greg Fahey did the TRIM study in which he rejuvenated the thymus, and metformin was part of his protocol. So metformin has longevity benefits. Now, personally, I find that using metformin interferes with my athletic performance when I work out. So I switched over to berberine. Do you think that berberine provides the same longevity effects as metformin?
Yeah, if we look at the actual mechanism of action, I mean, berberine does appear to share very similar mechanistic effects to metformin. We know that berberine can upregulate GLUT4 receptors, which is, you know, the receptors that enhance uptake into skeletal muscle cells of glucose. So if we look at whether or not berberine is going to have the same sort of longevity effect as metformin, based on the initial research and, you know, looking at the actual pathways in which it's working, it does appear that it may have, you know, a favorable effect on some longevity parameters. I mean, if we look at a lot of different chronic diseases, it appears that elevated levels of insulin does appear to play a role in mediating inflammation and oxidative stress. And we know that berberine does appear to have, you know, potent antioxidant effects. It's able to penetrate tissues. It's even able to modulate the microbiome. It's oftentimes used as an antibiotic or an antibacterial. So there's definitely a range of benefits with regular berberine.
So I would assume that you know who Dr. Brad Stanfield is. He's kind of in your neck of the woods. And it seems like he's kind of come really down on metformin. Now, he hasn't responded very much to berberine, but I would assume since their mechanisms are so similar that he's probably down on berberine as well. But in watching his videos, he came out and said that they did a study and that there's no longevity effect to be had from metformin. Now, that's a pretty recent study. But I would think that given the damage that we know that high insulin levels cause, particularly insulin spikes, and the detrimental effect that that would have on longevity, I would assume that these studies would need to be done over maybe decades to have a really accurate result. And I would think that berberine would probably have a similar beneficial impact. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I mean, if we look at the like some of the metformin studies, I mean, we can clearly see that both metformin and berberine appear to inhibit advanced glycation end products, the AGEs, which I know you've spoken about quite a lot on your channel. So if we look at the actual like gram for gram comparison, looking at like let's say 1,000 milligrams of berberine versus maybe 1,000 milligrams of metformin, first and foremost, it's going to come up, it's going to come back to the actual individual itself, whether or not they've actually been prescribed metformin. Is that going to be a, you know, a sustainable solution? Does it result in gastrointestinal upset? Does it have any other side effects such as lowering vitamin B12, which we see in the literature? So we need to do like a comparative analysis whether or not berberine, and a good way to do this is actually to utilize a continuous glucose monitor, the CGM device, and actually run the experiment. For those listening in, literally run the experiment yourself, see what happens if you use berberine, and actually do some tracking yourself to see how it affects your unique biology.
Right. Yeah. So on my metformin videos, I've gotten a lot of comments that seem to be pretty much divided. Half the audience is like, this stuff is great. I use it all the time. And I've had great results from it. And the other half is like, this is a killer. This stuff is poison. Do not use it. And what that kind of points out to me is the fact that everyone's different. Everyone responds differently to different molecules, to different substances, to different supplements, and that you really need to kind of figure out what works for you.
Absolutely. I mean, there's definitely an dosage variability and in terms of the way in which we all metabolize different ingredients, different drugs and supplements. I mean, there's genetic polymorphisms that influence the rate at which people break down certain medications. There's going to be the impact of the microbiome, how that affects the assimilation and utilization of certain medications. So definitely we need to factor in that unique variability in terms of all of our unique biochemistry.
Right. Okay. So we've kind of laid the groundwork here. Now let's take a look at dihydroberberine. What exactly is that?
Yeah. So dihydroberberine is simply a metabolite of berberine itself. And in fact, it's one of the 17 metabolites of berberine. And based on the research, it appears that this particular metabolite is more potent than berberine itself. And this is what we see quite a lot in medicine and even in drug discoveries. There's a range of particular drugs and medications in which, you know, developers will look into, and then they realize that it's either the prodrug or the metabolite of that particular lead drug that's actually eliciting the favorable effect. And we see this with, you know, a range of different medications. And so dihydroberberine, fortunately, we have the, you know, we have the scientific ability to determine that this particular form is more effective than berberine itself.
So I've heard that dihydroberberine is more bioavailable than berberine. Is that why it's more effective, or is it because it's a metabolite?
Yeah, so interestingly, berberine itself doesn't have a very good bioavailability. And so if we compare berberine to dihydroberberine, or DHB for short, is actually absorbed 5 times more efficiently than berberine itself. And so in the research studies, it actually increases blood levels of berberine much better than berberine itself. So we can think of it as like the berberine 2.0, like the advanced version of berberine.
Right. So do you think that's why it works better? It's just because it's absorbed better?
Yeah, definitely that is a, you know, huge factor. I mean, if we look at the milligram for milligram comparison, berberine itself, we see studies using 500 milligrams all the way up to around 2000 milligrams, you know, per day as a daily regime. But with this particular form of berberine, this DHB, we only need about 100 milligrams per day. That means that we're minimizing the GI related side effects or the gastrointestinal issues that most people report with regular berberine.
Okay. All right. So is there anything else that the research seems to suggest about dihydroberberine beyond what you've already talked about?
Yeah. So if we look at the literature, DHB, as I said, is, you know, much more better bioavailability, is readily absorbed by the body. There's minimal gastrointestinal side effects. So that's a big drawback with berberine. A lot of you know, individuals will state that they get the cramping, the bloating, the diarrhea, the constipation with berberine. there's no issue with this particular form, that DHB. And it also appears to have twice the half-life of berberine. So it means that it lasts longer in the body. Yeah.
Now, that's interesting. Okay, so dihydroberberine is available as supplements, correct?
Yeah, it's available now, yeah.
So what about cost? Berberine, I know, is fairly expensive compared to metformin, for example. So where does dihydroberberine come in? Is it more expensive, less expensive?
I'd say it's moderately priced. I mean, it's all about the milligram for milligram comparison. So obviously, we're not going to be getting as much, but we know it's going to be more effective. And so if we look at the actual dosage regime, this is what I've seen work well for a number of individuals, is 100 milligrams before, about 30 minutes before their highest carbohydrate meal. So that could be their lunch meal, their breakfast, or their dinner meal. And that way, you know, we're leveraging its GDA effect, glucose disposal agent effect, to shuttle the carbohydrates into the muscle cell and prevent that postprandial glucose spike.
Okay, so 100 milligrams, 30 minutes before the largest carbohydrate meal of the day. Now, is that right?
Yeah, that's a rough, you know, protocol that I think, you know, appears to exert a favorable effect on blood glucose parameters.
Okay, so this is good information to have. Is there any other info about dihydroberberine that you'd like us to know about?
No, I think we've pretty much covered it all. I mean, we did a good job at, summarizing the benefits, and hopefully, you know, your audience will be interested in learning more. So yeah, thanks for having me.
No problem. Thanks for joining us, Lucas.
Awesome.
See you next time. All right. Really enjoyed talking with Lucas. Learned a lot about dihydroberberine. Check out his channel, Boost Your Biology. Okay. Like I said at the start of the video, I recently published a program called The Longevity Guide, Biohacking Your Longevity. Now, I've taken the longevity path, and I believe that I'm younger, a lot younger on some levels, and in so many ways, I've had excellent results. And I can show you how I did it, the steps I took, the strategies I used, how I put a plan together. Now, if you'd like to learn more about the longevity guide, then click right up here, or on the link on the end page, or in the description below. And that wraps it up for this video. If you'd like to learn more about berberine, check out this video right here. And then here's the link to learn more about my program. And that's it. I'm out of here. Catch you next time.